Mr. Speaker, we recognise the fact that the criteria that we're using is very ambiguous, the words united and non-united. So we're going to set out as clearly as possible. We're going to make a case-by-case analysis. So, for example, in case of Syria, when the Free Syrian Army and the Syrian National Council got together recently, we think that we can call that as being a united army. Even though there is one small sector that may be different or have different branches, we think that in general we can call that a big united party. But against, for example, against the Awakening Movement post and during the war in Iran, where we only funded the Shias, and then we had the conflict between the Shias and the Sunnis later on post, and that went on to create a big division. I think that's something that we can call that's not united, that's ununited. And we think that that's the case, that's the criteria that we would like to be using. We think that the criteria should be whether there is a big clear wedge or a big clear division that exists between the two parties, and that's what we want to stand for. The support that we're talking about is everything. Recognition, military support, funding, all the kinds of support are things that we believe that the international community should not go about supporting. But until we have a recognised, a united opposition, we think we should abstain from doing so. So the first argument I'm going to bring to you today is how by supporting the ununited opposition is going to go about exacerbating the problem, going to create even a civil war. So the first reason we need to talk about is that we're going to go about creating a situation, we're going to pitch one opposition against another opposition. We need to recognise the fact that because we go about funding different types of oppositions, which are, even though they may have a common goal and a common enemy of toppling one leader, their objectives of doing so, and their want of doing so, and their vision of the society after the toppling of the leader is very, very different. In that instance, when we go about funding each and every opposition, giving them more weapons, giving them more ammunition, giving them more money to work with, I think it's going to create a situation where even after they take down, it's going to create a situation post-conflict, which my partner will go about enhancing. But moreover, even during the process of toppling down, they don't see each other as being an enemy also, because they see them as being someone they need to take out in the long-term future, so they think that there will be irrational for them to calculate that something they should do so in the process as well. Secondly, we think it's also going to go about empowering the dictator's rhetoric. When we see this clear division happening between each and every opposition group, the dictator can simply say, look at the groups that are fighting against us. They're all divided, they don't know what they want, they don't know what their goals are, they're not even united. Compared to the dictator, who can offer stability, who can offer a clear aim, vision, and a goal. But then in that situation, the rhetoric of the dictator that they can use to influence the people is going to be far more stronger, far more superior in comparison to when we don't have conflict happening between the opposition groups. Thirdly, we need to recognise the fact that it's going to weaken the opposition hold on specific regions. The fact is, these opposition groups are going to be able to hold a certain region when they take over it, if they have the money, if they have the capacity, if they have the capability. But the fact is, we're only going to be funding under their paradigm or under the status quo certain groups. We're not funding every kind of group. In that instance, we need to recognise the fact that there is going to be a disparity happening between the groups, between the power that each and every group has. In that instance, we need to recognise the fact that there are going to be areas which are more lightweight than other areas, which is going to make it easier for the dictator to come up and take over and regain that area. We think that's going to be harmful for the goal at the end of the day to go about taking or toppling the dictator down. We also need to recognise the fact that we're going to probably see an increase of support from dubious undemocratic governments or support groups or any other things that exist, such as Hamas and so on, those kind of things, who are not going to be accountable for the funding that they do, who are not going to be accountable for the weapons that they give them, who are not going to be held properly accountable to the support that they do. We think that's something in comparison to the international community, and when this in cases such as the UN and so on, it's something far more worse in as a plan. We also need to recognise the fact that it's going to make it easier to have the people align with the dictators themselves. There are going to be situations where the people are not going to have the weapons compared to the other dictators and so on, and we think that it's going to cause a situation where only one opposition group has that power, when only one opposition group has a bigger power than another opposition group that exists in society. As in the case in Afghanistan, where we only funded the Northern Alliance, the other tribes decided to join the Taliban as well. We think that kind of situation is also going to happen when we only go about funding one group, and that's something we see as being harmful. Yes, sir.
The harms that are coming from your proposal is based on the assumption that we're going to pick one particular party and fund them. Would you be okay if we fund everyone to balance the symmetry of power?
The fact is, if we go about funding each and every group, as I said, there is a clear division between the groups that exist. When there is a clear division that exists amongst the groups, and when they have different visions, different goals for the future, it's only going to give them more weapons to fight against each other with. That's going to cause even more conflict, even more death. So that's something we have a problem with as well. We also need to recognise the fact that that the weapons that we're funding, that the weapons that we're sending, that the money that we're sending is being used as a fight against the innocent on the ground as well. It's not only being used against the dictator which the whole group wants to topple, but we recognise the fact that these opposition all have different incentives and different objectives and an incentive to take each other out as well. We need to recognise the fact that these weapons are being used for taking out innocent civilians that want a new life afterwards. We think that is the same or akin to the West sanctioning murder, and that's something that our side of the house does not want to stand for. We need to recognise also that once the people are divided, they are put in a situation where they have to choose which opposition group to align themselves with, who they are most closest with. We think that creates a situation where these people become more apathetic, don't know what to support. We think it's going to become even harder for the opposition groups to gather support and gather movement and get movement. So for all these reasons, we think if we are going to fund or support opposition to dictators, we believe that they must be, they need to be united. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, even the most divided and sectarian of oppositions have a common goal when placed in the context of dictatorship, which is to dismantle the ruling institution. So this opposition in today's debate says that the obligation of the international community is to support any political entity with that specific objective and help all of them in a unified effort. Because let's have some recharacterization of what type of international community are we looking at. We see that this international community does not take sides in a fragmented opposition. We say we will support both, even if it is a secular opposition versus an Islamist opposition in Syria. We will leave the people of Syria to decide vis-a-vis a democratic election, but we won't decide coming from the international community. However, this support, of course, will come with things like constructive engagement. We will encourage them to reconcile their differences in peaceful means instead of reenact the horror of the dictatorship. And this advice comes with more weight and sincerity from the side of opposition, because now the international community is a friend to all as opposed to an enemy to one or an enemy to all oppositions. And even though there is a clear division apparently between these two oppositions, the international community does not possess a political objective within this dispute, Mr. Speaker, when it comes to between those two oppositions. So we are able to support all oppositions even though they're clearly divided under the status quo. It's not that they're clearly divided, that means they can't reconcile between each other, but we can foresee and support both sides of opposition. That'll be no problem at all. So I'm going to analyze to you the dynamics of civil war on four levels, how our policy assists the revolution against a dictatorship. But before that, a couple of rebuttals. They said this policy is exacerbating the problem to an extent of the civil war and oppositions will take each other out. Let's look at several responses. Firstly, it's a false paradigm because we do not support delivering fragmented support, and that's why the House has never considered any prospect of the international community being unified in its support. But the motion, the burden that the motion conveys onto them is to talk about exclusive harms of support altogether, as opposed to when the international community chooses to only support one part of the opposition and not the other. So they're running away from the burden of the motion. But our second response is this: under status quo, civil war is already happening, which is why we have an opposition to a revolution. So we cannot see the significance of the kinds of levels of harms you're conveying to us in this debate, firstly. But thirdly, we see that no opposition will prioritize the objective of taking out your bands of brothers before we eliminate the fiend that put us in this predicament in the first place. We see that the enemies of your enemies are your friends, not nonetheless. If you want to talk about reconciling political differences, that will be a second level priority because you will never reach that kind of prospect anyways if you don't take out the dictator. This is much more easier for these two opposition parties to realign their first priority and their first interest, and with international community support, we can act as a bridge between these two oppositions to make them see that there is a common goal that we can all achieve, and then we can move on to reconciling our differences. Our next response is this. They say that it's easier for one side to realign back with the dictator because one opposition should be weak and when the other opposition has support. But we say that that can never happen because the reason why we have opposition as rebel is because there's such distinct philosophical differences that you can never share with that dictatorship. You have gone through centuries and decades of oppression, of being deprived of your basic needs, but suddenly when you have another enemy, you go back to the first enemy that put you in that place in the first place. We say there will never be a prospect that will be available to many opposition parties because they are organized in nature, because they have made principled recognition of what their political objectives are. And then lastly, they say things about accountability and etc. We say that's going to happen like regardless. We say the international community has to make a cost-benefit analysis on what priority do you prioritize within this national context. You see, we always prioritize the opposition's revolution and their fights and their efforts. We try to mitigate the harms of consequential policy assistance later in that side of, after the policy has been given. That's a second consequential aspect of this policy. But lastly, Mr. Speaker, the point is this. They don't want to support the opposition, but not supporting the opposition does harm to the progression of the civil war within those dictatorial states. So the goal of the international community is to identify what do they want to achieve, which is to dismantle that dictatorship, and we see we do it best by supporting them. Let's go to the four levels of analysis, but before that, yes.
Ma'am, how is it that you help to dismantle dictatorships if these opposition groups use the money to attack other opposition groups in the first place?
I already told you two levels. Well, firstly, one of it is my substantive, but secondly, because your priorities are aligned, you have made recognition of your priorities. Your first priorities is to dismantle dictatorship, second, to only reconcile your political differences. I already told you that. Let's go to the first level. How it acts, how international community acts as a bridge between opposition forces. We see we agree with them. In the context of a civil war, it's very easy to embed hostility in any interaction, even to entities with a common goal. Everyone can easily look like an enemy, Mr. Speaker. But even with a common goal, Mr. Speaker, you have different modus operandi and different resources. What we're providing on the side of opposition is a singular institution that can connect them both. Both of them, this institution and the international community can convey messages between these two entities that you guys are more similar than you think, that you guys are more like friends than enemies. And you create these avenues where they can cross paths, when they collect resources, when they collect constructive engagement and advices. We are crafting an environment of enlightenment that makes them recognize they are more so like a band of brothers, that they can fight together and resolve their differences later. Here, and when they recognize that this reasonable entity can speak to both receiving ends reasonably, that maybe that other person on the other receiving end is just as rational and reasonable as I am. The prospect of reconciliation is better on the side of opposition than on the side of government. The second level is an empowerment of means, right? Because in their context, in a dictatorship, you don't have access to basic needs. Like local produce are your allies for food and weapon. Operations can only happen when you're near a water base. But international support means that you have a different point of entry for all these resources, and it can come in large numbers by sending hovercrafts. The lesser resources they spend on things like food, the more resources they can spend on things like recruitment and efficient operations to ensure that they have higher chances of facing that dictatorship. Third level is psychological warfare, because the leader who is in power right now is empowered because he is recognized as a legitimate authority, whether a semblance of trust from the people or the international community recognizes that he's the leader of that state. Now the international community is actively recognizing the opposition as what should be the legitimate leader of this country. There's a distinct point pressure on these dictators that they've never felt before, and he has absolutely no computation on how much support is being channeled, because their worldview is that the international community has infinite resources. I don't know who I'm battling against. That's the psychological warfare against them. But lastly, the morale of troops. Firstly, this opposition gains moral legitimacy in the recognition that they've never met before. But secondly, much like children needing the support of parents, now they can recognize there's an overarching structure that is pledging for their protection. They can have the highest level of morale to win the fight and perseverance against these dictatorships. So all those reasons we are very proud to oppose.
We would support a policy where we would choose to withhold any international support
until after the opposition members have united with one another in just the same way how we did in Syria, ladies and gentlemen, we hold international support which led to the unity between the Free Syrian Army and the Syrian National Council. We shouldn't premise our hopes by granting them weapons first and expect and speculate that they will only unite post-conflict. That was the exact mistake which we did in Afghanistan and Iraq, where we chose to find the Northern Alliance but at the same time other tribal groups. And once we kick off Taliban, ladies and gentlemen, infighting happened because they want to maintain power and they want to control power. And our policy, at least we can stop that from happening from the get-go. Two arguments will be discussed in my speech. Firstly, how your policy is a disaster when it comes to the execution of operations, because now you have no one standard operational body. Secondly, how your policy will create an unstable post-conflict society. I'm going to correct right. This is the most important point, because even if you are able to topple the dictator, the harms post-conflict is perpetual, just the same way how we took down Saddam Hussein for only 2 months, but the civil war happened for more than 3 years, like not 3 years, like more than a decade now. Four rebuttals which I need to solve. Number one, they told us infighting won't happen because we treat these people as our brothers and we have a common goal. That was the exact rhetoric when we armed like all rebel groups in Iraq, but it didn't happen there as well. Why is it so? Because even though you treat them, these people as your brothers, but you understand that you stand ideologically differentiated with them, ladies and gentlemen. I.e. maybe you are trying to pursue for a full-fledged Sharia state and another person would like to pursue for Western kind of governance. You might see the person as your brother, but you don't want that particular party to get into power, because if that party gets into power, that means you must take a backseat, ladies and gentlemen. The exact example which we pointed to was the exact divide which was caused between the awakening movement in Iraq, where there was a clear clash between the Sunnis and the Shias, ladies and gentlemen, when Nuri al-Maliki was brought into power. So obviously infighting will happen. You need to rebut by using an example, especially since this is an IR debate. Second rebuttal, ladies and gentlemen, they said, no, now chill guys, these people won't unite with dictators because they are ideologically different when you look at dictators. Well, this is the same thing when it comes to you guys, because even their rebel groups and opposition also stand as an affront to them. But the reason why they will most likely choose to unite with dictators, because dictators are more amenable to them, ladies and gentlemen, in contrast to these rebel groups. What do I mean by this? Because at least, ladies and gentlemen, these dictators have more clout and power in that country in contrast to a small opposition at the end. So they'll choose to unite themselves there. In just the same way, ladies and gentlemen, how most tribal groups, when they knew that they were being pushed or by the other opposition parties, chose to unite themselves with the Taliban, ladies and gentlemen, because the opportunity to win is more likely in contrast to supporting the other opposition group. The next thing, this is a funny argument, right? Constructive engagement. Constructive engagement will be better when both parties do not hold arms, ladies and gentlemen, because when you hold arms, even if a small mistake happened, if you bomb a place unintentionally, but might cause friendly fire, therefore you'll pit these two parties against one another. Constructive engagement will be better when they don't have weapons and they will add equal parity when it comes to arms. Therefore, constructive engagement will obviously be better under policy. Allow me to integrate one of my arguments. Under our policy, the international community cannot withhold support and use it as a bargaining chip. This was the exact situation which happened in Syria, which caused the unity when it comes to the government. Why is it so, ladies and gentlemen? Because these two groups are so desperate because they want to win the war, but they need to get weapons from the international community. That's when we force them to go towards the negotiating table to make concessions, and that's when we unite in one force. That's why we have the Syrian National Army now, ladies and gentlemen. That's far better in contrast to their policy, which is merely speculating. The final rebuttal, psychological warfare, and psychological warfare, dictators will be weakened now because of that. Because now like the international community is legitimizing an opposition or a leader. No, you are legitimizing leaders, different factions, different groups. We don't know which one to support, which one is right, which one is wrong. The reason why that's harmful is because of Yuki's argument. Because now either one of two things will happen. You divide people's support on the ground. A is either I choose to become apathetic because I'm just too like crazy, I'm like overwhelmed. Who should I support? Both parties are fighting against one another. So it's either become apathetic. But worse, you force these people to align themselves with the evil people, the dictators itself. Because at least the dictators are united in contrast with the opposition. That's clear, man.
If they are separated by such irreconcilable political differences to the point where they're willing to die, how can you force them to unity any more than we can?
The exact thing which we told you, because now they don't have weapons and they need to live. Both of them, ladies and gentlemen, want to live during the post-conflict process. And since they have no weapons, it's either they die or they choose to unite with one another. The example is Syria. Come on, guys. Two argumentations, right? Execution of operation. The first harm is that now their policy will perpetuate friendly fire with one another. That was the exact thing which happened in Syria when the Free Syrian Army and the Syrian National Council were divided because mortar fire was automatically targeted towards Aleppo, which killed a lot of soldiers under the Free Syrian Army and already caused short-term infighting, ladies and gentlemen. The reason why that caused 24 deaths, by the way, so that friendly fire is damaging because you are killing civilians and also your own brothers, which you call. The second problem here, you distort important covert operations from happening. Because fundamentally, ladies and gentlemen, if you look in Iraq, right, the awakening movement sent a spy within the Saddam Hussein palace itself, right? But because the other opposition faction didn't know that the person was a spy, they automatically bombarded the place, which killed that person. But that person had crucial information which was already ready to incriminate the party members itself. Under your policy, these people wouldn't know because there's a separation and information body which governed them. And we think that's problematic. What are the consequences of this death, right? The consequences here, now ladies and gentlemen, these people would want revenge because you have already killed their brothers because of the covert operation, because of mortar fire checks. And that's why you pit them against one another. But more importantly, you empower dictators here because no dictators can easily say the opposition are fractured, we are united, you should support us. Second argumentation, unstable post-conflict society. Because in this post-conflict society, these people would like to wrestle power from one another because they're divided. You want to say, oh, but they want peace. It's impossible to expect speculative peace when you've already killed my brother during the war. When you have waged war against me, ladies and gentlemen, especially when you want to claim for your own religious mandate or secular mandate, it's better for the peace process to happen during the war with the dictator, because you are fighting with one another and you bring down the government together, ladies and gentlemen. An example we point you to was, again, the example which happened in Afghanistan and Iraq. We managed to take down the government in only 2 months, but the civil war had lasted for more than 10 years because there's a clear divide between the Sunnis and the Shias, ladies and gentlemen. Where have we reached so far? We need to make a judgment call. Arming them will not make situation better, but will make situation worse when you pit them together during the war and after the war. I'm very happy to propose.
Mr. Chair, the situation that we are facing at hand is a time-sensitive situation. For example, in Syria, 70,000 people have died. And the most important thing for us to do is to stop the aggression that is coming from the dictators. We reject unequivocally that the opposition, small opposition groups, will align themselves with the dictators. They are the opposition, guys, and they are killing each other. We don't think any of this opposition would want to align themselves with the dictators. So it doesn't make sense whatsoever. The case that came from Saif government was contingent upon this opposition groups uniting. So they argued that all this civil war will occur and things like that. But civil wars will occur anyway if we don't support them, ladies and gentlemen. So all the harms post-war will happen anyway. So we don't see how their side improved the situation post-war. Iraq, they gave the example of Iraq. That's a horrible example. Situation was worse under Saddam Hussein, and as compared to now, the violence that are happening now are more sporadic as compared to concentrated violence against the Shia under Saddam Hussein, ladies and gentlemen. So we think we can afford to take that cost. So fourthly, they argued that they want to use support as a bargaining chip to unite this opposition, ladies and gentlemen. So they gave the example of Syria, so where they say, if you unite, then we will support you. We think, ladies and gentlemen, considering that they say the difference are deeply entrenched, like it's a religious difference, like Sunnis and Shia, for example, secular political parties and Islamist political party, we think that the kind of reconciliation that you're creating is a false reconciliation, because these people are desperate. They need the support, ladies and gentlemen. Hence, they will agree temporarily to align themselves with each other. That's problematic. But secondly, we think that this is a time-sensitive situation. When people are dying, our priority should be toppling the government that is killing the people. They want to wait for this opposition group to come together, ladies and gentlemen. We question them, how long will this take? It could take years, ladies and gentlemen, when more people will die. It has been 22 months and 70,000 people have died. We have reached unprecedented levels of horror in Syria, ladies and gentlemen. We don't think we are going to support that at all. Lastly, he talked about information sharing, ladies and gentlemen. If we don't support them, they will still be
they will still be ideologically different, and your covert operation and sharing of secrets won't happen at all. But in our situation, it's better, because now the West is the uniting body between these two opposition groups. Because now they are getting the support from the West, they are obliged, and the West has plowed over them to advise them to work and cooperate with each other, ladies and gentlemen. So juxtapose no uniting factor with our proposal where the West can cooperate with this opposition, ladies and gentlemen, to allow them to fight effectively. We think our side is better as compared to theirs. So our worst case scenario is better than theirs at the end of the day. But lastly, I don't know why they make this debate about arming rebels, ladies and gentlemen. The West is smart enough to analyze things on a case-by-case basis. Yeah. Support doesn't entail giving guns, Sadiq. Support can mean giving communication equipment. It can mean giving food, ladies and gentlemen. It can mean giving financial assistance, ladies and gentlemen. So the type of violence that people carry pink shotguns and shoot each other, ladies and gentlemen, doesn't count, because we think that support can come in many other ways. Let's look at my argumentation. We think that if the West refuses to support opposition within these countries, it will make them worse and it will radicalize these groups even further. But before that, yes, sir.
If you're only supporting a soft case and you only give food and economic aid, then what about your time-sensitive argument where we need guns to take them down?
No, okay, fine. We can take them down because any form of support will create a resurgence of morale on the part of opposition to fight effectively. Even if you want to make this debate about guns, we are willing to support that, because at least on our side, ladies and gentlemen, we have a uniting factor to allow moderation to occur within this group. If you don't give them guns, they will resort to other alternatives, because they need these guns. Go to Iran, for example, and get guns. Or go to other radical Arab countries to get arms, ladies and gentlemen. And the kind of violence that you're talking about will still exist, because we're talking about a situation of desperation, ladies and gentlemen. Let's look at my argument on how this will radicalize these splinter groups on three levels. Firstly, ladies and gentlemen, we think that if the West unequivocally condemns these dictators, but at the same time not supporting the opposition, which is the only alternative in replacing the dictator, ladies and gentlemen, we think that the kind of perception that it creates within the country and amongst this opposition group is that the West is not for change within this country. They are tacitly endorsing the current government, ladies and gentlemen. Yes. This is problematic, because in the long run, we believe that the opposition will strengthen themselves and get into power. And when they are in power, ladies and gentlemen, we think it creates no incentive for this new opposition that is in power, the new government, ladies and gentlemen, to cooperate with the West. Because the West abandoned them in time of need, ladies and gentlemen, when the West is supporting all other opposition that are united in other countries. There is a form of double standard that is placed on the West towards them. And that's problematic, especially when we're talking about post-revolution countries, nascent democracies, ladies and gentlemen. We think the West should forge relationships at the early stage within these countries to make them be moderate, to make them align, to not make them more radical. But secondly, we think because of the relationship that they will have with the West, we think the West can consult them on things that will lead to them fighting the war moderately. How is this so? We point to you the example of other countries, ladies and gentlemen, the pre-partition India, the civil war and pre-partition India, ladies and gentlemen, where there were no support from the West, there were no uniting body, you know, trying to reconcile the different actors. We think it led to a lot of war crimes, it led to a lot of things that were horrendous, ladies and gentlemen. We think when the West is involved, we think they will be more responsible, because now we are advising them that you must be responsible in war. You shouldn't kill the dictator once you topple him, put him in the ICC. Things like that are important, and only the West can help and advise these people, and the way to do that is to have some form of cooperation with them. And support allows us to have that cooperation. We are extremely proud to stand in opposition.
We had an extremely crazy opposition today. They tell you that someone wants Sharia law, fine, let's pay them money. And someone else wants secularism, let's pay them money too. If any one of them comes to power, they'll like you because apparently you supported them too. No, you also supported their opposition, empowered the rebels who actually fought them in that freaking war. That means they're extremely much more hostile to you in the first place. Three key issues that decide this debate. First of all, does it harm the ongoing war right now? Second, moderation and unity, who achieves it best? Third, post-conflict situations, assuming their scenario leads to a post-conflict situation, how does it lead to a peaceful long-term solution? First issue, right? How does it harm the ongoing war? Because they tell you that, oh, but this, if you don't support them, the war becomes even worse. On the other hand, they themselves conceded. But if you put them in such a situation, they will come to a temporary reconciliation. You see, that in itself is good enough to show you that no, once we withhold support from them, they will unite, and therefore we will not see that coalition operating in the first place. Second, right, we tell you that people will support dictators or at least become apathetic. They said, oh no, people won't, right? No, look, if people in homes are there right now, right, they're on the verge of entering into a war. There are two solutions for them. Number one, support the government and be safe. Number two, take a risk, support the opposition, stand for your principles. However, the opposition, if it's much more divided, likelihood becomes that people will seek stability and therefore then support that dictator. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, this is how you manifest support for the dictator in itself. This is how you increase the rhetoric of dictators that, oh, you look, they're actually not even fighting for your sect. They're actually fighting for a completely separate sect altogether. That's why they will divide support in the first place, and therefore people will look for stability and support dictators in the first place. This is extremely crucial in getting support and winning the war, because if people don't support you in the first place, this will create prolonged insurgencies in the long run. Sit. Then, ladies and gentlemen, we told you about information asymmetry, right? Because, for instance, from simple things like spy operations to even engaging in war collectively against and taking the city of Bashar al-Assad, for instance, if you are not united in the first place, even if all of you are funded, it means you can't communicate with each other because, well, you hate each other, and that means that you can't have proper tactics into engaging in war, right? You don't even know, like, for instance, if the two groups are together, you can say, let's attack the city right now, together, right? But unfortunately, in your model, there's an information asymmetry, which means these parties can never communicate and engage in war efficiently. Third issue, right? Then, third party alternatives, I don't know what they were talking about. Anyways, second issue, right? Moderation and unity. Okay, look, they tell you that moderation and unity will occur if we give them money. No, they are much more likely to be hostile to you if they have to fight for those resources anyway. Then they said, oh no, wait. They'll get money and they'll get weapons from third party alternatives such as, I don't know, Hezbollah or whatever. But the thing is, that will happen under your model too. When you force them to compete with each other for those weapons, they will also look for alternatives. That's not mutually exclusive.
What?
But more importantly, right? When moderation and unity occurs, that's not our model. When you tell them that unless you unite, your efforts and your principles will not be accounted for. This is when they will be forced to go ahead and unite themselves with you, right? We don't think you will have a say in just by giving them weapons, because you're also giving weapons to their enemies, right? We also think essentially that they said, oh, this is time sensitive. That's exactly why they will come to an agreement in the first place. They said, oh, agreement is temporary. We don't think so. When you come to a reconciliation between those two parties, it means that you have come to a conclusion where you will fight the war together. Now, when you win that war, that means that you are at the government together. You can no longer separate yourself, right? Yes, here.
Sit.
What is that? Essentially, that means that once when you are reconciliated and fight that war in the first place, that means reconciliation no longer becomes temporary, because if you are both in power together, that means you can easily hold elections, and that means it's in your interest not to go back on that contract. Yeah. However, if you have to fight those people to come to power, it's going to cause massive harms, and before I move on to those harms, yes.
All the harms that you're talking, don't you think that if we support these rebel groups, it grants more legitimacy for the international community to intervene later on if problems happen, because they were involved from the start?
No. Like, if you don't need to be involved in a war to say, let's, you know, intervene there because a lot of humanitarian torture is going on, right? You don't think, oh, I gave you money before, that's why it gives me the right to intervene. That argument doesn't work. But essentially, look, post-conflict situations, who does it best? They said, we will hold democratic elections. Are you freaking kidding me? Like, one party has to fight everyone else in order to win that war. Their argument about prioritization is completely false. Because no longer are you prioritized to only kill off the dictator, but also other parties, because that's the only way you can be the next government. This means that when these people come to power, they have a perverse incentive to be hostile to the other sectors of opposition, and they will then ostracize those communities because these people were the ones who were opposed to them achieving power in the first place. And when that happens, the United Nations can't do shit, right? And they will be even more hostile to you because you are the exact ones who funded those rebels to fight them in the first place. Under your model, under our model, it's actually united, and therefore that hostility doesn't exist. Second issue, right? Not only do they go ahead and discriminate against other sects because they have to fight wars against them, this also means prolonged insurgencies exist within that country. Because other sects which failed to get power in the first place will now seek revenge. Because other sects which were also necessarily opposition to the dictators will now also oppose your party because you are the one who is depriving them of power. This means these sects which will therefore go ahead and create insurgencies and try to put you out of power in the first place. They say if differences are so entrenched, then how will they reconcile? First, two responses. If under your model they're entrenched as well, how do you expect them to reconcile under your model once you give them so much money to go to war? But at least under our model, we have a direct incentive, a direct bargaining chip, which they don't have. Which is if you don't, then we won't give you money, the necessary money to go to war. This means they have a direct incentive, in spite of the entrenched differences, to come to reconciliation, which will enhance both parties' agendas. What have we shown you here today? We've shown you three things. First of all, it is absolutely necessary for a united opposition in order to have a long peaceful process in that country, because otherwise the war itself will get much worse. There will be infighting, there will be insurgencies. This means that these people will hate each other's guts and there will never be reconciliation. Under our model, you force them to moderate themselves. You force them to unite. Under theirs, there is never a post-conflict situation which is peaceful. Because only under ours will each section of society be represented in the government that topples the dictators. We are supremely proud to propose.
Mr. Speaker, we had a government bench that assumed a lot of things in today's debate. They assumed that support from any Western state automatically asks for weaponry. They assume, ladies and gentlemen, that violence will always exist between members of the opposition. They assume that examples win IR debate. If we have to give a best example speaker award, it should go to Sadiq. And for any rookie debaters in this room, you may proceed to the room right adjacent to us right now for him to continue that whole lecture on, you know, Iraq and whatever he was talking about. Ladies and gentlemen, we admit that we made mistakes in Iraq, but a lot of the violence there that overflowed after Saddam Hussein was overthrown was not necessarily because we supported a certain group of people. It was also because we invaded them for WMDs that didn't exist. We committed horrible atrocities and we installed their government without allowing them to install it themselves. But crucially, Mr. Chair, we want to ask the question of the Saeed government. How dare they homogenize Arabs as backwards? How dare they categorize Arabs as regressive, incapable of accepting democratic reforms and values such as tolerance and peace, ladies and gentlemen?
On that point,
the crucial factor of why people oppose dictatorships is not because they have another idea of installing another government, it's because they are tired of being oppressed. They are tired of not being able to have any say in how their country is run or how their children's future will be. The core principle of any revolution against dictators is self-determination, ladies and gentlemen.
Even
in a place like Egypt, we saw the events that happened on Black Friday, and we saw how Muslims and Christians could come together and decide that enough is enough, ladies and gentlemen. Two points of clash in today's debate. Firstly, how do we best precipitate a united opposition? And secondly, let's talk about post-conflict reconstruction and the idea of whether or not guns help constructive engagement. The Prime Minister came up first, so let's talk about a united opposition. The Prime Minister came up and in a long forgotten speech, he told you that empowerment of a splintered opposition exacerbates conflict between them. Secondly, it weakens opposition's hold on territory and funds. Thirdly, it encourages opposition groups to find funding from benevolent actors. So let's put it in two paradigms, Mr. Chair. What happens without support and with support? We told you firstly that without support, you have no form of discussion or discourse between the splintering parties. Without the Friends of Syria coalition of the Western states, ladies and gentlemen, we cannot expect that the Syrian National Council or the Jabhat al-Nusra would come together, ladies and gentlemen, and share their ideals and share their ideas on how to best precipitate a better government. But on the second level, we told you that attacking other groups, because they were complaining that if we give them weapons, they'll fight. That won't happen, ladies and gentlemen. Why? Because fundamentally, the success and failure of revolutions is not just about having strong rebel groups, it's also about relying upon things like public support. We rely on the public, on donations, we rely on them to hide our rebels, we rely on them for things like intelligence, for example. And we think that the public in itself, ladies and gentlemen, will be well aware if an opposition group is hijacking the revolution for their own ideals, ladies and gentlemen, and they are very happy, and we think they can make that kind of decision to determine for themselves. That's why Maoist rebels in India or China and in Latin America, ladies and gentlemen, will never receive that kind of support to overthrow the government, because their ideals are all based on violence and things like oppression and common values, ladies and gentlemen. Thirdly, we told you, okay, assuming but not conceding that violence will exist, which side better controls that violence? Firstly, we told you, ladies and gentlemen, that when you engage with the West, when you have a relationship that, like the Friends of Syria have with the Syrian opposition, for example, you allow the West a control mechanism onto these opposition groups. So if your opposition, who do or do not have guns, start fighting, we think that our side better controls that violence, ladies and gentlemen, because now they are answerable to an international community. If the Free Syrian Army commits atrocities, they know that their boss has to face John Kerry and explain that whole situation, ladies and gentlemen. So it's much less likely, and that's why the Syrian rebel fight is not as violent or not as bad as what the Syrian government does. They don't resort to things like killing innocent people or taking hostages or committing crimes of war. But on your paradigm, they will do this and they will go unpunished and unchecked. Moving on, ladies and gentlemen. We also told you that there's a harm if you do not allow this kind of discourse and discussion. If you don't bring opposition groups together to talk and discuss things, what you allow these opposition groups to do is to hijack these revolutions and turn them for their own interests. Before I move on, yes.
Do you agree that time sensitivity is an issue, that they are so desperate to avoid that their existence is contingent on them uniting during the time of war? Why would they do it during that time?
No, hang on. The reason is this, right? People have different ideals of how a country should be after the dictator and that oppressive regime is gone. But the core focus of all these groups is to get the dictatorial regime here gone, ladies and gentlemen. So the core focus is, that's why the Jabhat al-Nusra and the Syrian National Council can come together and speak about these things. They can have this kind of engagement, ladies and gentlemen. Doesn't make sense. You have to prove why that's less important. So let's go on to post-conflict reconstruction. They told us that if we support them, then these new governments will befriend dictators, that there will be further perennial violence, and there will be hatred to the West. But we told you a few responses. Firstly, because we have established such support, and because we have allowed them that idea of self-determination, it's more likely that they will turn away from benevolent actors like Iran and like Hamas, for example, ladies and gentlemen. That's why when the American embassy in Libya was bombed, the Libyans came together and protested against it and said, "We are friends of America, ladies and gentlemen." Secondly, we told you that even if violence does occur, there is an accountability, ladies and gentlemen, because now the Western states, those that supported the opposition groups, have more pressure on them to solve these situations, ladies and gentlemen. But on a third level, when violence does happen, and at least somebody will have a responsibility to do something about it. So let's move on very quickly to the idea of guns and constructive engagement. Ladies and gentlemen, guns are a necessity. It's a necessity if they feel it is a necessity, ladies and gentlemen. So if we don't give it to them, they will go and look for it from Hamas and from Hezbollah, ladies and gentlemen. At least if we give them the support, we have a control mechanism on them, and they will be accountable to us, ladies and gentlemen. For all these reasons, we are very proud to oppose.
Between the matter contribution of Gulf and all, because PM's harms were exclusive to only fragmented support instead of any support like the motion required them to defend. then DPN's harms is contingent on disunity. And they can only avoid this harm, their policy can guarantee us unity. Because we don't disagree that unity is good, right? That's true, isn't it? But the likelihood of unity that they've established to us is no more brighter on this side than it is on that side. As opposed to the massive contribution from opposition, where all of our benefits are exclusive to the support from the international community per se. It is not contingent on circumstances. It's not conditioned on other benefits materializing. We're not running away from this debate. Let's look at two things. Because this debate comes down to two things. Firstly, let's look at disunity. Secondly, let's look at winning the revolution. Disunity. The government's own characterization defeats their likelihood for opposition groups to unify. Because what did they tell us in the first place? Because I never said the differences were entrenched. You told us that in your first speech. I don't think it's that bad. But they told us philosophical differences. They will never see eye to eye. Yet somehow they can do it when it comes to realigning with a dictator. Yet somehow they can unify under your bargaining chip. So A, they're not that different after all, and money can be the solution of all political differences. But B, your bargaining chip is not different from ours. You see, they needed money to win the war. We're telling you we're going to help you win the war. Rationality under your paradigm exists under our paradigm as well. We're telling them we can help each other. They never rebutted that rationality analysis coming from my first speech, that these two oppositions have a hierarchy of priorities and have a common first goal. And right now, the situation is bleak for both of them to fulfill their first priority. We're telling you it could be better if you join forces. The same rationality reunited the Free Syrian Army and the Syrian National Council. We don't see why it doesn't apply under the side of opposition. It's not that hard. So secondly, we talked to you about the bridge. And this makes more sense now when you talk about philosophical differences are not irreconcilable after all. They say, you know what? They'll still see the West as hostile because you supported other opposition groups as well. But A, versus not supporting them at all when your help was most crucial and when they were at the most weakest point in time. And therefore, their fight loses because at that point in time, you never gave that support. But B, our support. Help them win their cause in the first place. Logic is on the side of opposition, Mr. Speaker. But thirdly, why are you talking about the harms of infighting as if the opposition is also not against infighting, Mr. Speaker? We are also against infighting, so we had two substantives that were smooth coming from the side of DPM. Let's look at the second thing, winning the revolution. And let's just look at status quo. Under status quo, it's already civil war. Opposition is already not fighting together. Your worst case scenario is no worse than status quo, Mr. Speaker. We need to change those circumstances. And now let's analyze the benefits. Which two government or opposition benefits the cause better? Their benefits only materializes if this bargaining chip works. Then only they will get all the benefits that they listed out. But that's a burden that is still shaky at best. And we give you a counter analysis on how we're creating unity through the international community as a mediator. And we told you that this never goes down. If this party can be reasonable, because you have to be reasonable to communicate to the international community, then maybe they can be reasonable with each other as well. They can convey messages between these opposing allies that you're more like friends than enemies, Mr. Speaker. As opposed to their benefits, let's look at our benefits that materializes directly just with support. Number one, the empowerment of needs. They directly need this in order to have any forms of advantage within the revolution. And because they have an interest to get continuous support, more support, Mr. Speaker, this is why they have to be accountable, this is why they have to be reasonable, this is why there's more incentive to reconcile between opposing allies. I told you secondly, also never rebutted, psychological warfare, the kind of support and the message that you give to the dictator that this is a losing fight is unrivaled. Thirdly, I told you on the morale of troops. They need this overarching support to get the kind of push and legitimacy that they've never gotten before, Mr. Speaker. On the harms of the many hostility in deconstructing future relations, Mr. Speaker, you have to come to people at their time of need, not when they're prosperous, because now you know that they are ingenuine or insincere, Mr. Speaker. We help them now, they can recognize that, and they'll help us then later when they've established their own government. For all those reasons, we're very proud to oppose.
Most of their arguments and rebuttals are contingent on the fact that the opposition will not unite even during times of desperation, even during times that they know that death will visit them soon. This is not the situation for Iraq which he tried to portray, where we would allow Saddam Hussein to be in power. We're not for that. We're saying that allow them to wait a little bit longer. That's when reconciliation can happen because they're desperate. That's when they can challenge the dictator as a united front, and that will lead to a sustainable outcome. I'll answer the three most important questions. The first one is the linchpin of this debate. If you are able to take that, we will win. Will they unite? Because all sides throw rebuttals and arguments based on this. They said it won't unite because there are some form of philosophical differences. They said we contradict ourselves. But we told you, these philosophical differences will best be resolved during times of war because of the time-sensitive nature which you talked about, because they are desperate, because in order for you to promote your philosophical differences, you need to live, you need to stay alive. If you expect them to reconcile post-conflict, they're no longer desperate, ladies and gentlemen. They see you as an opposition. Therefore, your policy will make the situation worse. Yeah. So they will most likely unite, right? Because of the very, like, evil characterization which you talked about. But then you say, oh no, this is false unity. What did Mubarak tell you? This won't be false unity. Because during the time of war, when you are united, you fight side by side with your brothers in arms, they choose to fight for that guy. Under your policy, these are fractured groups. They don't fight under one collective body. But if you really want to say that this is false unity, then false unity will also apply in a post-conflict society. But that's far worse, because now false unity will no longer stand, because now once the dictator is gone, I have a gun, you have a gun, and we can fight with one another. If you realize, ladies and gentlemen, if I'm able to prove this point, your argument of going to Iran, endorsing oppression, hostile after you win, will not stand. Because the comparison is way better on the policy. Because if you are united, there's no incentive for you to be hostile towards the Western forces. Because Western forces arm all of you, even when you're under one umbrella. That's when you have an incentive to share information, because you treat the person next to you as your brother and not as your enemy who would want to go against you and impose a different section of law upon you, ladies and gentlemen. So obviously, it will be better. But never mind, assuming that we didn't win the bargaining chip, although they won it for us by arguing they're so desperate for it, even if that's the case, it's still better than our policy. They say, Arafat said, how dare we say the Arabs are intolerable people? Well, they will be intolerable if you stand directly against them, if you don't even want to negotiate with them, if you choose to kill them in cases of friendly fire. That's why the example of the Awakening Movement and the Northern Alliance dispute was something which is particularly important. They said there's an incentive because public support must be won by both sides. But public support is better when these two forces are united. That's when the Syrian public, as I told in my speech, only supported the Syrian National Rebel, the Syrian Rebel Movement, when FSA and SNC united with one another, ladies and gentlemen. Under your policy, often the public will be confused. Who should I support? Who will win? Which one is the right rebellion? Maybe, because the dictator itself is a united front, and that's a better option for me to choose. But let's analyze the worst case scenario under both sides, right? And this is really important for the context of this debate. The worst case scenario under our policy is that yes, these people will get into power, but at least there will be no civil war, ladies and gentlemen, and there will be no guns and arms for me to use to pitch against one another. But the worst case scenario under your model will be far worse, because now negotiation will only happen after you bring down this dictator. And a power struggle will happen, a power struggle which is characterized with arms coming from the West. Under our policy, those arms will not exist because the West is not giving them at all. An example of Iraq was unique in this debate, ladies and gentlemen. It's not because of weapons of mass destruction, because we funded the Sunnis and the Shias together, which caused a decade-long civil war. We think unity will most likely happen when they really need it because they are desperate, and that's when they'll treat them as brothers. Under your policy, they're no longer desperate because they've already won the war, but now there's another person who wants to implement the Sharia law. Well, I don't see him as a brother. Now he's the dictator which I want to bring down.